This is a diorama building. I'm gonna start off with making a couple of rock bases. So what I start off with is a lightweight hydrocal, and this is basically bought at your local models railroad store. Instructions say to mix this up a little bit. So this is mixing this up. The instructions also say the measurements of this is 1 1/4 cup to 1/2 cup water. There's 1/2 cup water in here. And this is a fresh, I'm gonna open this up. Might get a little dusty. And gonna measure out 1 cup of this stuff. I don't have to pack this stuff down. One and a half, or 1 1/4 actually. So about half of this, maybe a little bit over because I have less in there. And slowly pour this stuff into the water. Once this is in water, I'm going to take a piece of plastic to mix the stuff up. And you want to thoroughly mix this up. That's thoroughly mixed up. Clean off my piece of plastic and let it sit for a little bit. Now, these are molds I picked up from railroad hobby store. And they're pretty good to use. Rubber and reusable. You could bend them and make different shapes with them. You can also put Play-Doh to round out certain shapes, which I've done in the past, and you can create a little bit more smaller rocks, and I'm going to do that as well. So your standard, what you do with the Play-Doh is you can create little dividers. So what I'm doing here is creating a little couple of dividers between the parts so I could get different shapes of rocks. Another divider here. So, small divider up here. Now this allows me to customize what my rocks look like so. Close on my Play-Doh. And this stuff is pretty much ready to pour. Carefully pour a little bit into this. And then in here. It's been about a couple of hours and it says dry to an extent. Now, the longer you wait, the more it's gonna dry up. So I'm gonna let this actually pull it from the mold. And you can feel that it looks like this. And you can tap on it and it's got that, you know, kind of like a fairly porous, and it's got that chalk-like feel to it. So that's, I'm just gonna let that sit and completely cure up overnight. And I'm gonna pull these parts off. And you see that the Play-Doh has formed decent sections. You can kind of just chip these excess areas off. Now, since these are still kind of brittle because they haven't really completely cured yet, so they can break apart fairly easily. So I'm going to be taking a little care when I'm removing these out of here. Now I could just wash that with some water and it should remove the rest of the Play-Doh. I want to reuse my Play-Doh, so I'm going to try to not have as much of the hydrocal in there as possible. And from my mold, I have my various pieces of rock. Now once this is fully cured up, I could go ahead and sand the bottom of these flat. Right now it's still kind of, there's still a little bit of moisture in these, and once it dries overnight or over a period of 24 hours, it should harden up nicely. Back to my rocks I have, it's cured. I've glued them onto this base. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to weather them. So you'll see I have a few test pieces here. What I do here is I put a little pigment inside my cup and I add water until it's fairly liquid like this. Oops. Let's soak that up a little bit. So, I'm going to go ahead and mix in some water to my pigments. And this is basically doing kind of a wash. The pigments I'm using is, are these water-based acrylics that I picked up at, you know, local craft store. They were a couple of bucks, and I used to do this process using enamels, but I figured I could go less fumey and go with water-based products. So right now I'm just gonna mix in. So I have a raw sienna, a burnt umber, and a pebble color. So add in some more water here. Now your water ratio, if you have it, you have a lower water ratio, meaning it's the paint pigment is a little bit thicker, and you get these dark spots when you do this technique. And I thinned it out a little bit more, and I got lighter spots. So this is commonly known in model building as a leopard technique, I think. But it's very, very similar to the fade or the filter technique. Except, you know, I'm not using enamel paints, I'm using a acrylic-based paint. So now that I have these ready and I have my test pieces, so I could go ahead and kind of load up my spongy brush and have my test pieces and just kind of dab all over the place. Same thing with this test piece. Now you see that this dark, it's a little too dark because I had the earlier mixture was a little too dark. So I think this works as in my mix ratio is decent. I'll go ahead and paint that up. Now I'm going to go ahead and do that to my rocks here. Just kind of spot it on. I could take the brush and kind of dry up some of the spots. Some heavier spots with a little bit more, oops, a couple of heavy spots here, heavier spot here, and that's first color. I'm gonna clean my brush. Get rid of most of that. And go on with this darker color here. Oops. Again, do the same technique, just kind of spot it up a little bit. Now this will sort of make some sense when I'm done with this. Gotta make sure I turn this around so I get all sides of this. What's nice about, you know, this technique is because the surface of the of these rocks are very, very porous, so it tends to absorb these pigments fairly nicely. So I'm gonna go ahead and apply my last color, the slate, and just kinda hit it all over the place. Same thing with this piece. And these are just test pieces I'm using just to kind of finish off my paint and experiment a little with the color toning. And then my very last mixture will be black. So I'm just gonna add very little bit of black here, like this, and add my water. Granted, it's kinda dirty water, but black is a pretty strong pigment. I'm not too concerned about this. Now this black should be lighter than the rest of your mixtures. So I'm just gonna make sure that, because black is a very, very, you know, strong pigment. And since I'm using this as the last color, I don't want it to overpower things. So again, with my test pieces of rock, I'm gonna go ahead and see how that looks. And you see that it's pretty powerful. But if you see as it kind of dries a little bit and it goes into all those little tiny little crevices, it gives that rock much more depth. And you see that happen right before your eyes, kind of like so. And you see the comparison of the two parts, and this black just ends up blending everything together. So let me move these out of the way, and I'm just gonna do that with this piece. Just take the black and just go over liberally like so. And you can see how it affects lighter pieces, darker pieces, as you know, as it dries, it's gonna bring out all those little details here. So again, maybe I shouldn't use all this black. I need to save it for my piece. So I'm going to set these off to the side while I work on the main piece, this piece right here. Load up my brush with the black and just go crazy nuts over this. Take my brush and pick up some of the excess a little bit. As this dries, I can always go back with some more of this, some more of the black, or clean my brush a little bit. Go back with some of the colors I had earlier. And just highlight some of those cleaned off areas. And there you pretty much have this, my little rock, so to speak. I'm just gonna let that dry like this dried. So I could go back to playing with, you know, this piece and using the rest of my black to balance out the dark colors that showed up on this particular piece. And you could experiment with different colors and get different effects. I would recommend looking around your neighborhood, or sometimes you go to different places, take a look at your surroundings and see what the rocks kind of look like, and you could sort of recreate that effect by just looking at the colors of the rocks and then applying this method. So you see, as it's slowly drying, you know, there's a dynamic color tone to this. As this is, you know, drying, it's starting to get a couple more nice tones coming out. So I'm just gonna let this sit here and just dry overnight. The diorama has some time to dry after I have sealed this with a clear coat. So I don't want these colors to run. I don't want them to peel off on these next steps. I sealed it up first. Now, along this bottom area, I want to create some sand. So what I'm doing is I'm going to use a paper clay. So first off, I'm going to start on a small section. I'm just going to apply a little bit of Elmer's glue. Just kind of spread this around the surface with a brush. This may not be necessary, but it helps with the paper clay adhesion. Start off with a small section. Now, paper clay is exactly what this is. It's paper clay. Now, what's nice is you can use water to kind of thin this out a little bit. It's gonna kind of apply it onto the surface roughly. Gonna push it around a little bit. No. I'll get to these edges. I'm just gonna take a pair of scissors and clean off the edge of this. Press it down a little bit more. Now this gives me a little bit of a textured layer on this base here. So I'm gonna push this out to about there. Now I could go ahead and start working with this. What I'm using is just my string rod, and I can create some little waves with this. I can create all sorts of different textures just by using this tool. Okay, use your fingers, or you can use the back end of this to create different effects. I want some curved surfaces, and you can sort of, since this is pretty much clay, you have a decent amount of time to sculpt with this product.